All right. So, again, Daryl Baskin here, and I am not a uveitis specialist. This is a lecture I intended to give last month. As a retina specialist, you do see from time to time some white dot syndromes, and you do have to deal with uveitis before you refer it out sometimes. So we'll get started. I've seen most of these entities at one time or another. Feel free to interrupt and ask questions. This is not Vegas. As somebody asked, this is a picture I took off on a boat on the Seine, and it was kind of dark, as you could tell, and it didn't have a tripod, and I was really happy that it wasn't blurrier than it is. Those are good days. Okay, no financial interests. Probably we'll talk about off-label medications. White dot syndromes, otherwise known as inflammatory chorioretinopathies of unknown etiology, which is a mouthful, so we'll just call them white dots. There are 6, 7, or 8, depending on, or 9, depending on how you want to number it. Birdshot, ampi, serpiginous, multifocal choroiditis, punctate inner choroiditis. SFU is one we hardly ever talk about. Mudes, ARPI or krill disease, which we hardly ever talk about. And Azor, which I have yet to see a confirmed case of. I'm not down that it exists. I'm just saying I haven't seen it yet. And then patients don't often come in with the diagnosis of a white dot syndrome. So you have to rule out other things that can look like them. Again, white dots are not, as far as we know, caused by an infection, although probably all of them have some viral correlation. So you have to think about other things like ocular histoplasmosis, tuberculosis, syphilis, etc. So these are dots that I show people a lot of times. Probably most of you have seen this, but when I was a kid, I was given these 9 dots and told to connect them all without lifting up a pencil, drawing 4 straight lines. And the way you do it is that, I think I figured it out without anybody telling me, but I don't remember anymore. The reason I bring that up is because sometimes you have to learn a little bit more than what is required in the book in order to make sense of things or to solve the problem. Because the book would have you memorize this table and that table and that table. And if you just go through and try rote memorization, it's really not going to serve you well. Then you also have to remember that there's all these differentials and memorize those too. So, you know, you don't want to be the person who's listing off 10 things when you see a patient that has a couple of white spots in the back of their eye. You really want to narrow it down. So the goal in this lecture is to create a pattern for you to recognize things and to show you as many pictures as I can in this short period of time. That will help you to sort of, in the future, recognize it for what it is. This is sort of the way I think about the white dot syndromes. You have these 3 kind of in the triad. You've got Azor, multifocal choroiditis, and Mudes. These are all considered Azor complex diseases. I don't know why they picked Azor, because to me that seems like the least common, but that's what they are. They're in this Azor complex. Azor has a relative called AAOR, acute annular outer retinopathy, which we will briefly touch on. The book does mention it. MCP has a close cousin as well, and that's PIC, punctate inner choroidopathy or choroiditis. And Mudes has something the book doesn't really talk about, but this is the only time you'll hear me talking about it. Acute idiopathic blind spot enlargement syndrome, which you will see from time to time, called AIBES or AIBES. Then there's 3 others that really aren't related to the Azor complex, and they look pretty different from those as well. So you have acute posterior multifocal placoid pigment epitheliopathy from here on called AMPI, serpiginous choroiditis, and birdshot retinochoroidopathy, which I'll just refer to as birdshot. So some of these don't even have white dots. Azor, acute annular outer retinopathy, and acute idiopathic blind spot enlargement syndrome. So white dot syndrome is a little bit of a misnomer. So when you see white dots, you can automatically not say those 3. So here's something with white dots. And Jared, do you want to describe what we're looking at here? This is a Panaret image.
This is a fundus photo of the periphery. The media appears clear. The vessels, kind of hard to tell if there's any vasculitis. They look pretty sharp. There's some multiple sort of whitish deposits appear to be in the probably retinal or probably retinal, subretinal, and some pigmentary changes. Looks like a little bit in the superior temporal periphery there.
Great description. So you get these multiple fluffy white subretinal deposits, some RPE changes, and these are white spots, but this is not a white dot syndrome. This is retinovitreal lymphoma or primary intraocular lymphoma. This one is a white dot syndrome. Does anybody know what this is?
Birdshot.
It's birdshot. So you see kind of this radial white semi-ovoid lesions under deep to the retina, and they are more numerous nasally. Nasal and inferior can be the most common places for you to see them the densest. They're usually not quite into the macula, though they can be, and they're highly correlated with A29, although 7% of the general population also is A29 positive, so don't just order this test willy-nilly. It may lead you down the wrong path. If you have the haplotype, the A29, you're 224 times more likely to develop this disease, but nobody really tests babies for this. Okay, so their presentation, blurred vision, floaters, which isn't as common as some of the other white dots. Nyctalopia is also a good distinguishing presentation, and color vision disturbances. They can have vitritis. And again, we already described what the lesions look like. They have a very wide range in size, 50 to 1,500 microns. And I mentioned the nasal and radial distribution. I tried to highlight some of the words in red that I think are important. And they do not become hyperpigmented over time as opposed to, say, MCP. Retinal vasculitis, CME, optic nerve head inflammation, these are all what we call structural complications. And in general, if you follow along in this lecture, entities that have vitritis in general are going to have retinal vasculitis, CME, cataract, optic nerve head inflammation, not necessarily always coming along with that. And then they can get optic atrophy, epiretinal membrane, CNV. So things to keep in the back of your mind, Vincent's heard this several times, is certain entities are going to be more likely to get CNV than others. So think about that, and then think about which ones are going to get vitritis, because then you can think about the CME, the ERM, and the cataract. Those are going to follow vitritis a little bit more closely than those other structural complications. So again, what we're seeing here is an image from birdshot. You see the little kind of yellowish ovoid lesions. We're looking at the superior temporal arcade of the left eye, and you can see a little bit of some very mild whitening at the edge of the vein there. And this is what we call sheathing. They do get vasculitis. The FA does not always highlight these lesions, but it's useful in identifying other issues such as CME, optic nerve head leakage, retinal vasculitis. Hypopigmented lesions do not show transmission defects on the late phases of the FA, which implies that the loss of pigment is concurrent with the loss of choriocapillaris. Okay, so you don't get that window defect. And then the ICGA demonstrates multiple hypofluorescent lesions. All these are going to have hypofluorescent ICGA lesions. They're not going to be hyper, I'm pretty sure. As we go along, we'll see if I need to correct myself. And they're going to be more numerous on ICG than they are on exam or FA. So a lot of information. Autofluorescence, you're going to need hypoautofluorescent areas and areas of RPE atrophy. That makes sense. And they're going to be more numerous and not always correspond to fundoscopic lesions. Autofluorescence can also be helpful in revealing this placoid, macular, hypoautofluorescence. I wouldn't spend a lot of time thinking about autofluorescence on these. It is extremely helpful. It's fairly new, and there's still new items coming out in the literature. Steve Yeh has come out with some great papers, NIH. And, you know, serpiginous is fantastic with autofluorescence. We'll talk about that. But other than that, I wouldn't spend a whole lot of time on it. Diagnostically, it's probably not as highly testable this year. The ERG is really important to know about birdshot because not many of them talk about their ERG findings. They get this delayed 30 hertz implicit time, and they get this diminished scotopic B wave amplitude. They get visual field loss as well. Okay, so therapy. You got to use steroids, and you want to use early introduction of immunomodulatory therapy because steroids don't work all that great, and you're going to be treating these people for a long time. So that's one of the other things I want you to think about. Which of these disease entities is going to require immunomodulatory therapy because it's kind of a yes-no. Again, this is another image of birdshot. You could maybe argue that you could see some cystoid macular edema there. Another birdshot picture. Notice how kind of inferior and a little bit superior nasal that you see the lesions. You don't see a lot out temporally. You don't see much going on in the fovea. And here you could see some vitritis. Okay, now you see some widespread RPE, stippling of the RPE. I shouldn't even say that, just some mottled hyperfluorescence that corresponds to some RPE damage. You can see some petaloid macular edema, optic nerve head leakage. And then this is an entity that has white dots, but this is not what we call white dot syndrome. This is syphilis. This is area nasally is actually an exudative retinal detachment with a bunch of sort of subretinal white lesions there. And this is a white dot syndrome. Does anybody know what this is? Brent? Not birdshot because we're seeing kind of involvement in the fovea. They're kind of large. This would be like a male that might come in and tell you they've got some photopsia and some scotomata. So acute posterior multifocal placoid pigment epitheliopathy. 50% have a viral prodrome. The HLA associations are not very high yield. They do have, AMP has a lot of associations. It's probably because it's caused by more than one thing. And the one that I think is important to know is cerebral vasculitis, simply because it's misspelled, but it's also important to know because it's potentially life-threatening. There's other entities you want to work up as well, but that one's one that could kill somebody. You can get a sudden onset, again, asymmetric. This one is typically more often bilateral than a lot of the other white dots are. And this one has photopsia. A lot of them do have photopsia. You can get some mild inflammation anteriorly and posteriorly. And usually this resolves in a few weeks with not much in the way of treatment. This is a block early stain late disease, which we'll go over again later. And then for the ICG, it's somewhat helpful. I don't routinely order this on my AMP patients. And then your hypoautofluorescent lesions on autofluorescence lag the appearance of the fundus lesions. So it's going to be less numerous on autofluorescence. And this is probably a choroidal process. This is a great picture of blocking early. And then if right below the one I circled there, there's a kind of a large one. You'll see in the next picture that it's a lot brighter. And you can see that it's staining late. And I highlighted a different one that's staining late there. You've got to think about a few other things when you see this. I mentioned sarcoidosis as a possible association, but sarcoid can look just like this. Choroidal metastases can look like these. Viral retinitis, and that's a very dangerous one to not catch or put on your differential when it's the cause. Toxoplasmic retinochoroiditis, pneumocystis, or pigeonis can look like this. And we'll briefly touch on ampiginous or relentless placoid chorioretinitis. Just for now, know that there's a lot of things that can look like AMPI. And you don't want to miss acute retinal necrosis. Risk factors for vision loss. Most people are going to come away with pretty decent vision, 20/20. 20 to 25% of people are going to have vision that's worse than 20/40 when it's over. So just remember that not everybody has a benign course. There can be foveal involvement that's a risk factor for vision loss. That makes sense. Older age, you could probably argue that one's intuitive. Unilateral disease, you'll have to memorize that one. If you get the second eye involved and there's a big interval, that's a risk factor for vision loss. And of course, if it recurs, that's bad. These are just some more pictures that I got from an article. You can see that there's a lot, I think there's a lot of variability in the way the AMPI looks. A lot more variability than you may get, say, with mutes or birdshot or serpiginous. See the RPE alterations there, and you know, a lot of changes on OCT. So here's another image. This one has mild sort of hypopigmented lesions. Does anybody want to hazard a guess as to what this might be? This is kind of a tough one. Not mutes. Good. They're right. Not mutes. This is not showing up super well in the picture here, but this is a sunset glow fundus after VKH. Shows up a lot better on exam than it does on pictures. And then this is serpiginous. Excellent. So this one has a very typical appearance of my, in my opinion, although it, again, it can be mistaken for AMPI. Geographic choroidopathy, helicoid choroidopathy are some of the older terms. Again, I don't think the HLA associations are important except for birdshot. This is typically unilateral, painless, decreased vision, scotomata. It's funny, it says unilateral on one, and then it says bilateral on the next. So I apologize for that. It is usually asymmetric. It can affect both eyes. And you get the pseudopodal expansion from the optic nerve. The disease activity usually appears at the leading edge. So this is where autofluorescence is really great. I'll talk about this on the next slide. But you can, if you're going to get CNV or some kind of new activity, it's going to happen at the edge of these little pseudopods. And the autofluorescence is really going to show that up very nicely. And some of these folks can have really poor vision. So this is an early blocking, late staining. If you have CNV, you're also going to have some early hyperfluorescence and, of course, the late leakage. The ICG, it doesn't show you any more lesions than you would get with the FA. But again, the autofluorescence is really helpful in highlighting disease activity. This is a patient at one point in time, and the question is there CNV present? Kind of hard to tell just looking at this. You don't see any subretinal hemorrhage. You don't see a grayish or green membrane. So you get your FA, and you have 18-point seconds in the upper left and 19.6. So you see these kind of blocks early. See a little bit of maybe, is that some hyperfluorescence kind of right next to them? You keep on tracking that. It's a little bit more hyperfluorescent. Is it expanding beyond its original borders? We got one shot of the left eye, and our final verdict was no, it's not active. But you kind of look at this, and you have to stare at it for a long time, and you ask them if they're having symptoms. Certainly right next to the fovea, it doesn't look active. A couple places where maybe there's some questionability. But certainly that's why the autofluorescence has been really nice for illustrating any activity there. Again, these are folks that you're going to want to use systemic immunomodulatory therapy, because it's such an aggressive disease. Cyclosporine is also one that's used, although I'm not sure if that's one of the more common ones. Again, I'm not a uveitis specialist, and if these people need immunomodulatory therapy, I'm usually sending them to a uveitis specialist. This looks pretty active. You see a couple months later, you see some RPE changes, pigmenting in 3 months later, and that's kind of your natural progression. This is a related entity. This is called tuberculous serpiginous-like choroiditis or choroidopathy. And just want you to notice a few things. I can't use a pointer here, but right next to the nerve, you don't see any involvement, whereas serpiginous, you just about always see involvement at the nerve and then spreading out from there. You see these confluent plaques, but they're also hyperpigmented. So these people have a positive PPD or from a TB endemic country, and you want to treat them with TB meds, especially if they haven't been treated before. And then sometimes you end up using some immunomodulatory therapy as well. Okay, so here's a white dot syndrome. Anybody give me a couple of things that this might be, Vincent? It can be a white dot syndrome. Looking at this, you wouldn't know if it is or not. Sympathetic ophthalmia, maybe. I don't see enough of these to tell you that it never looks like this, but there's something a lot more common that can look like this. I think you've got a buddy here who's going to help you. Could be PIC. So the lesions look a lot like PIC. They're very small. The thing that makes this not look like PIC is how peripheral some of the lesions are. PIC can do that, but if you're going to get tested on it, they're almost always going to be in the fovea or the macula. One other thing, if I told you this isn't a white dot and doesn't have vitritis, histoplasmosis. And so if it did have vitritis, you might say multifocal choroiditis. But again, it's not. It's a fairly quiet-looking eye. But you see the peripapillary atrophy. You see the tiny punched-out lesions. You don't see the CNV, and there's no vitritis. Those are kind of your tetrad or triad. So this is a patient who has something similar to that. You see the peripapillary involvement. You see slightly larger lesions. You see what looks like maybe old CNV in the fovea. And you can't see any vitritis in this point, but this is a patient that does have multifocal choroiditis, panuveitis, MCP. asymmetric. This is one of those young myopic females with photopsia, enlarged blind spot, and decreased vision. So several of these can give you an enlarged blind spot. Several of these can give you photopsia. So I would kind of track in your mind which ones give you an enlarged blind spot. So this is one of them. Punched out lesions, peripapillary, mid-peripheral, anterior equatorial regions. You can get inflammation in the anterior segment and in the posterior segment. Okay. Seems like an over-the-top animation there. But when you see inflammation, that pretty much rules out PIC and histo. So good to keep in the back of your brain. And then these lesions are smaller than Birdshot or Ampi, bigger than PIC. They evolve into these atrophic scars, varying degrees of hyperpigmentation, as opposed to Birdshot, which does not hyperpigment. And at presentation, about 28% are going to have CNV, according to one study. Cataract in about that many, and CME in 14%, ERM in 5%. Again, structural complications because they have vitritis. Imaging, again, blocks early, stains late. ICG shows you more lesions than your exam or FA does. And they're usually clustered around the optic nerve. Again, that kind of fits with having an enlarged blind spot because you have this peripapillary involvement. I wouldn't worry about the autofluorescence right now. 75% of patients are going to have permanent vision loss. This isn't like mutes. This isn't like AMPI. These folks are going to lose vision. And it's not just due to CNV. When PIC patients lose vision, we're going to talk about PIC soon, it's usually due to CNV. So you're going to use IMT, immunomodulatory therapy, for these folks. And then if they have CNV, you're going to use all the treatments that you have available for that. Here's a great picture. Peripapillary involvement. Large, medium-sized lesions, bigger than PIC, smaller than AMPI, well-circumscribed, variable pigmentation. You could even argue that maybe there's some vitritis centrally. This is MCP. Here is an FA of that at 22 seconds. And here we have a little bit later. Window defects. Hard to argue that there's much in the way of vasculitis in this picture. Maybe a little bit of some staining superior temporally along that vein. This is a patient that I saw, not in 2006, but a couple years later. You could see all these little, you could say they're punched out lesions if you want. I mean, they look like they're punched out lesions. They're not as deep as PIC. You see CNV. Looking at this, you could say histo or multifocal choroiditis. But not when I saw the patient, but somebody saw vitritis somewhere along the lines and it made the diagnosis before I came in. This is a couple of years later. Things have scarred in a little bit. This is her autofluorescence. And you don't see any hyperautofluorescence. Again, this isn't serpiginous, but serpiginous, you'd be looking for that hyperautofluorescence along an edge, what we call a leading edge of the pseudopodal lesions. Here, we're just looking for anything abnormal, but this really highlights where the fact that the RPE is just eaten away. And then this is great. This is one of the first OCTs I took. And again, you see these little tiny areas where you have the RPE in Brooks is just gone. And then you see below that, you see multiple hyperreflective choroid sclera in there. And then you see in the center, there's a pigment epithelial detachment that's hyperreflective that fits with her old CNV. This is another patient. This is not a white dot syndrome. We're doing all right on time. Does anybody want to guess what this is? Something we've already seen a picture of once. Could be lymphoma. Excellent. In this case, it's a resolving VKH. I think the reason I put these in here is because VKH, you don't typically think of as a white dot, but it can show you white dots, and especially when they're untreated or if you're catching them at a resolution or some other phase. I think of VKH, you have massive exudative retinal detachments that cause all these little streak-like stria going in every direction from the nerve. In this case, you don't see that. You don't see the sunset glow. You don't know if they have poliosis or Sugiura sign. So you're just kind of looking at this image and wondering what it is when you're at a conference. This could be VKH. Here's something that, look how tiny these are, right? So when you see tiny little white dots, you want to think about PIC. And then you can see a little bit of subretinal hemorrhage or intraretinal hemorrhage, just temporal to the fovea. This is punctate inner choroiditis or choroidopathy. So young myopic female, MCP. These folks are younger than the MCP patients. MCP are typically average out at 45. PIC is 29. So they get metamorphopsia, the scotomata, photopsia, asymmetric loss of vision. The thing to think about with these guys, high rate of CNV at presentation. So this is, of all of our white dot syndromes, this one's the most likely to have CNV when they present. 79% in one of the series that was quoted in the BCSC, as opposed to MCP, which is like 28%. Birdshot's like maybe 6%, and that's not just a presentation. So FA, you get that early hyperfluorescence. That's not early blocks, early stains like this is not one of those. ICG shows you lesions that correspond to what you see. You don't get more on ICG. That's also different than a lot of the other ones. And then most of your treatment's going to be directed towards the CNV. You're not going to be doing immunomodulatory therapy. Now, PIC and MCP and some of these other ones can overlap. They're, that Azor complex, if you listen to Rick Spade, who's sort of the godfather of imaging for OCT and has some great papers on white dot syndromes, he'll say that he's shown quite a few patients that have like PIC in one eye and MCP in the other and things like that. So there's clearly overlap. But for our purposes, we kind of want to separate them out and create distinct sort of memory spots in our brains so that we can kind of return to those and think about them stereotypically. When you actually practice, it's going to work out a little bit less clean. So this is a patient with PIC again, showing you some early or mid hyperfluorescence corresponding with that lesion, that CNV. So this is another white dot syndrome. Does anybody want to maybe say what they think this is most closely associated with? This is a patient I saw when I was a first year in July. What's that? Well, there you could think about Muse. That was certainly one of the things we thought about. Sarcoid, excellent. So I still remember seeing this patient in walk-in clinic, and my third year came in. I'm not even sure. Yeah, I don't remember what I thought it was, but third year came in and said, oh, this is ampy. We got the FAs. Like, I still remember doing like a fist pump or something. Blocks early, stains late, and all this stuff. And we called Gary Lane, who was my attending at the time. Actually, we called him after one of the other attendings. She had some optic nerve involvement. We thought she had ampy. We did a very thorough workup. Her optic nerve involvement didn't really go away that much. And Dr. Lane, she ended up getting dumped into Dr. Lane's clinic when I went to BAMC. And anyway, he repeated the workup about 5 or 6 months later. And she had a chest x-ray, she had some hyaluronopathy, then they ended up getting tissue and she had sarcoid. So ampy can look a lot like sarcoid or vice versa. And she ended up having this chronic sort of sarcoid optic neuropathy, and she's not in the military anymore. Anyway, this is a different kind of patient. This is the first thing that was said, MUDES, by process of elimination, we're getting there. You could see some very, very underwhelming looking little white dots in the macula, in the fovea. You could even argue that you see a little bit of granularity within the fovea. This is MUDES. Healthy young myopic females, pretty strong trend. In fact, almost all of the white dots are going to be more common in females than males. There's only a couple where they're equal. 80% have blurred vision, photopsia, enlarged blind spot again. 33% have a viral prodrome. They have multiple discrete little white to orange spots, and sometimes I find that they're easier to see with a photo than they are in your exam. So I remember even looking in one time, not seeing much, although she came in with symptoms of an enlarged blind spot. This is when I was a fellow, and I was thinking MUDES, didn't see the white dots. We got photos, and the white dots, I think it was one that image I just showed you, they're very obvious on picture. So that granular macular pigmentary changes are pathognomonic, variable vitritis, disc edema, vascular sheathing. So the FA is also not a blocks early, stains late. So now we have two that are not blocks early, stains late. Punctate, hyperfluorescent lesions in a wreath-like configuration surrounding the fovea. We call them wreath-like because they basically surround the fovea, not because each individual one is wreath-like, although I've heard that a couple of times. ICG, they're more numerous than seen on exam. The book mentions ERG. I've never ordered an ERG on a MUDES patient, but they're listed as having diminished A wave and early receptor potential changes that are diminished and that are reversible. All right. So, and I think the early receptor potentials were related to some like, does anybody remember? I just gave a lecture like 3 weeks ago. I don't remember. See, not that important. All right. OCT, multifocal ERG, EOG, localized process of the RPE photoreceptor complex. Excellent visual recovery within 2 to 10 weeks. Without therapy for most people, they can get some residual photopsia and enlarged blind spot, and they can get recurrences. I have a good friend who developed this when I was a fellow, and she had some 20/25 to 20/30 vision in one eye, and the other eye ended up having an occurrence, and she had diminished vision in that eye too. So it's not a totally benign disease. It's got these associations with Azor complex diseases and acute macular neuroretinopathy, which we're not going to chat about today. This is the ICG, very numerous little lesions. I believe this is my friend that has MUDs, and you can see all the little white dots there, and foveal granularity there, and this is the OCT that shows, you can see just in the fovea, and I would point, but I can't get the pointer to follow quickly enough. You can see that kind of the ellipsoid zone is a little bit irregular right in the fovea. It's got some kind of focal elevations. The RPE slash Brooks is kind of irregular as well right there. But then I want you to really notice right next to the nerve on either side of it, you can see loss of the ellipsoid zone and then the interdigitation zone. You can't really make out that well. And the ELM also is almost gone on both sides. And again, that fits with their symptoms and large blind spot. Let's see. All right. And then I have one more OCT. This just shows you what one of the white dots looks like. You get this disruption of the ellipsoid zone. You can't really make out the ELM. There, good. And this is just showing you that reflight configuration on FA. Anybody know what this is? This is a tough one. It's sympathetic, so we're not going to talk about sympathetic right now. This is something I'm not going to spend a lot of time on either. I could not find very many pictures of it. This is krill disease or acute retinal pigment epitheliitis. Young adults, acute unilateral vision loss, metamorphopsia. Again, hard to distinguish it from anything else. No treatment, resolves in 6 to 12 weeks. And they mentioned this yellow halo. And then this is something along on our differential that we haven't talked about yet. Let's see. Let me have Dan describe this image.
All right, so kind of this photo of the left eye. And vessels look okay. Optic nerve looks maybe a little swollen. Got some edema around there. And then along the upper arcade, you have looks like some retinal lesions, some yellowish or almost confluent lesions, maybe some vascular tortuosity in the upper arcade, and that extends out to the periphery as well. The media looks maybe a little hazy, but I don't see anything that's obvious for vitritis.
So we've got optic disc edema, we have outer retinal whitening. We'll say there
vasculature.
There's probably maybe a little bit of some sheathing. Kind of temporal, superior temporal, and maybe a little bit of vitritis. What's the thing you're most, what is one of the most concerning things this could be?
ARN?
Yeah, so acute retinal necrosis is something you never want to miss. You might be sitting there looking at this and going, could this be an atypical form of serpiginous or ampiginous relentless placoid choroid retinitis? Could this be AMPI? When you see the optic disc edema, you could see that with AMPI. You could see that with sarcoid. But when you see that kind of retinal whitening, and then peripherally there's even more lesions, you see a little bit of vitritis. You don't have anything that's just yelling at you that this is herpetic. But when you from this lecture, but when you take a step back and think, okay, what are some infectious things that could cause this? You always want to, if ARN, acute retinal necrosis, could be a possibility, you want to bring that to a retina specialist right away. Treatment, the timing of treatment is extremely critical. We may talk about that tomorrow. And this is something totally different, but has white dots, has got cotton wool spots. There's nothing pathognomonic about this picture. This is just somebody we saw with lupus when I was a fellow, and this young lady had a terrible story. I'll tell you some other time, just in terms of some of the management decisions that were made by the other, by rheumatology and actually neurology in this case. So lupus can look like that. This is an unusual one, SFU, so retinal fibrosis and uveitis syndrome. Again, it's so rare that I had to go find pictures in the book, which I hate to do. And very uncommon, healthy young myopic females. It's so uncommon, like they didn't even have like anything listed for what it looks like on FA. So, I mean, super uncommon. I would just know the name and then have it on the differential if the picture you're looking at doesn't fit anything else. Okay, so getting on some of the less common but highly testable things. This is a picture from Rick Spade. What I want you to notice in the letter A, that color fundus photo, is that you see a ring of yellow stuff going around the disc with some hypopigmented kind of area internal to that, that you also see showing up on the FA and the two ICG images. In my opinion, this is acute annular outer retinopathy, and I'm pretty certain he called it that in 2004. The book has this picture in it, I think in the uveitis book. This is an autofluorescence image. This is of the same patient. Yeah, this is of the same patient. And in the book, they call it azor. And again, I'm not an expert, but I have to say that the acute zonal occult outer retinopathy, it's occult because you don't see anything. In this case, you see something. So I don't want to hammer this home too much because I hate to disagree with the book on something I'm not an expert. But you could see something, therefore it's not occult, therefore it's not azor. There probably might be some changes in the future, but certainly Don Gass would not have called this azor. So I call it acute annular outer retinopathy. This is a picture of azor that's a little, you know, this has been active for some time. This is not from the book. This is from Fujiwara. But you could see, if you take a look at that upper left color fundus photo, that there's a little bit of, you could say, some modeled RPE kind of atrophy around the disc. And if you look at the autofluorescence, it's really obvious where the RPE atrophy is. Looks like they've got some CME, you got some stretching, maybe not CME, but certainly an ERM, maybe some retinal thickening. You look at the OCT, you could see a mild epiretinal membrane with loss of the foveal contour. Visual field loss, this is azor. Photopsia, so it's this loss of a zone of outer retinal function. They get ERG changes, they get a delayed 30 hertz flicker, they get visual field changes. It's important to order visual field in these folks. And the EOG, reduction in their light rise, they get a mild botrytis sometimes. Early in disease, your FA is going to be normal. Later on, you might get some transmission defects, again, from the RPE atrophy. I'm not sure if I agree with the autofluorescence description. Certainly, you can get some mild autofluorescence, like, let's go back to this one. The arrow is pointing at a little bit, maybe along a vein, but it's usually just kind of black, and then it goes back to normal. Most developed bilateral disease, recurrences in a third, legal blindness in 18%, and there's no known treatment. Steroids are used commonly. Some people have used IVIG, I believe. And here's some more autofluorescence images. Again, it's where they're active, they're just, or where the disease has taken place, it's pretty much hypoautofluorescent. You could argue that maybe there's this ring of hyperautofluorescence around the fovea. Perhaps that's the case, but that's certainly not what they've been arguing with the AAOR. So let's kind of review some of these. We talked about the azor complex diseases, azor, MCP, mutes being kind of the linchpins, and then you have PIC very close to MCP. Those are kind of the big four that the book talks about. We threw in AAOR and AIBES just for, I think, completion of that azor complex. Some people even put acute macular neuroretinopathy. We talked about AMPI, serpiginous birdshot, and how those really don't look like the other four. And then there's another one that we mentioned briefly called ampiginous. That was its proposed name. It got rejected, and they had to rename it relentless plaque chorioretinitis. Suffice it to say, they wanted to call it ampiginous because it looked a lot like AMPI, and it looked a lot like serpiginous. It was kind of halfway in between them. So birdshot is written in purple here just because it's so different from everything else. And we'll just do a little quiz here. All right. So, Brent, MCP versus PIC, which one has the older age on average? Right. So MCP is older. And which one has smaller spots, Jared?
Pig.
Right. And Dan, which one has botrytis?
That's MCP.
Good. And which one's more likely to have CMV at presentation, Chari? Yep. And which one has the worst visual prognosis, Vincent?
MCP.
Yep. Even though it's not as likely to get the CNV. Okay, so we'll compare AMPI and serpiginous. I think these are pretty different, but which one's more likely to have a viral prodrome? Brent? AMPI is a little bit more likely, although it could present without one. Jared, which one's more likely to have papillitis?
Serpiginous.
Close. AMPI can. This is good. Dan, which one's more likely to have botrytis? They both can, but which one's more likely? Yep. And Vincent, which one's more likely to have CNV? Yep. Not a high, not one that's high compared to, like, say, PIC or MCP, but compared to AMPI, yes. And which one is the worst visual prognosis, Chari? Yep. All right. This one, next one's easy slash hard, depending on, well, it's hard for me, so it's probably hard for everybody else, I guess. Okay, which, so we're going to go through blocks early, stains late on FA. I just want a thumbs up from the audience. Birdshot, yes or no?
Yes.
I need to see thumbs some up. Thumbs, people.
Thumbs up.
Thumbs up or thumbs down? All right. Okay, mostly thumbs up. Yes. AMPI? Good. Serpiginous? See, one thumbs down. Yes. MCP? Thumbs up. Pick. Thumbs down. All right. Mudes is down. Good. And what to remember about pick and mude, pick has early hyperfluorescence, some variable late staining. You can get CNV, and that's going to obviously show signs on FA. And then mudes, you get that reef-like configuration, some early hyperfluorescence, some late staining. All right. So ICG, which one has... So in general, you could say when you do the ICG, you get hyperfluorescent spots. They either correspond to the exam or they're more numerous than your exam or FA. So we're saying which ones have show more spots on ICG. All right, who says birdshot has more spots? It's a tough one. All right, it does. All right, I won't do this to you guys. All right, no to AMPI. I think this is important to see once you see the end of it. So AMPI does not. Serpiginous, yes. MCP, yes. PIC, no. And MUDES, yes. So I haven't quite finished memorizing this one. I just put this slide together this morning, but I've always just kind of said I'll learn ICG later. But if you think about it, the ICG is more numerous than exam on all but AMPI and PIC. I don't really think of those two as having anything in common, but this would be something I would say they have in common. And then finally, IMT, which are you going to use immunomodulatory therapy on birdshot? Yes, I'm getting thumbs up. AMPI? Nope. Serpiginous? Yes. MCP? Nobody wants to put their thumbs up anymore. Yes. PIC? No. You're going to use anti-VEGF. And MUDES? No. Again, there are exceptions for all of these patients when you actually deal with an individual person. These are the sources, and I will try to put this up on the website soon. So, any questions, guys? All right, thanks for your time.